So a man went in for what turned out to be the world's shortest job interview. Only two questions actually were asked. The first question was, so why were you discharged from your last position? The man said, well, I was overly ambitious. I always wanted to take my work home with me. Confused, the interviewer said, oh, well, then who was your last employer? The man said, First National Bank. Abundant Advent, that's been the theme of our messages this Advent season, and today we are focused on the candle of joy. People sometimes wonder, like, why is the joy candle pink? You might think maybe the love candle might be the pink candle, right? Because we think of Valentine's Day and all the pink hearts that go with Valentine's Day, and so that'd be the candle of love would be pink. But no, at some point in the distant past, somebody decided that the color of joy is pink. And so the third week in Advent is the pink candle, the joy candle. Today we're going to do something that I do from time to time. It's been a while since I've done, and that is we're going to do what I call an interactive sermon. So there's going to be questions that I ask, and it's going to be a very short sermon if you don't answer them for me. If we don't have some kind of a discussion about things. And so a little bit more interactive than the typical sermon here. But we're going to talk about what joy is, why joy is available to us, and where we see it in the Christmas story. And most of the scriptures that we see today are going to be on the screen behind me. But I wanted to ask, first of all, like, how would you define joy? What is joy? Who's got an answer for me?
Contentment.
Contentment. Very good. What was that? Okay. Yeah. Anything that, I love that. Anything that makes your heart sing, right? Good. Anything else? Let me ask you this. What's the difference between joy and happiness?
Happiness depends on your environment.
Happiness depends on your environment. So it's more situational, right? And that's actually a great answer to that question, Bonnie. We can go to the next slide. So here we go. Here's the difference I would define between happiness and joy. Happiness is like a mud puddle, right? It rains. We saw this probably in your driveway or in your street this morning, right? It rained overnight. When it rains, there's a puddle. And the puddle is there for a while, maybe an afternoon, and then the sun comes out and dries up the puddle, and the happiness is gone. That's the way happiness works sometimes, isn't it? Right? It's an emotion, and emotions change, right? I mean, my emotion can change from one extreme to the other based on the next text message that I get. Amen? We see that in our lives. Our emotions change, and happiness is an emotion. It's temporary. It's fleeting, and it kind of depends on our circumstances. Joy, though, is different, isn't it? Joy is like that second picture, which, well, what I searched for was a spring-fed river. It continues. It lasts. It's deeper. It has a source that's not what is going on in my life at the moment. It's an abundant source. And real joy, authentic joy, the joy that's described in Scripture, is something that can only be produced in a believer in Christ. So my next question is, how is joy produced in the life of a Christian? Where does it come from?
Our relationship with God.
Our relationship with God. That's where it comes from. It comes from our relationship with Jesus Christ. More specifically, if we can go to the next slide, Galatians 5 tells us where it comes from. We did a sermon series on this a couple years ago. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. And we talked about a couple years ago when we did this sermon series on the fruit of the Spirit that joy is one of those things that stems from our relationship with Christ through the Holy Spirit that lives inside of us. And so we talk about if you have a joy problem, it's not a thing where I just need more joy in my life. No, you need a stronger connection to the Holy Spirit, because where the Holy Spirit is in our lives, it produces joy the same way that an apple tree produces apple, that an orange tree produce oranges. If the tree is healthy, it will produce fruit. And if our relationship with God is healthy, it will produce in greater measure the fruit of the Spirit. Our faith within Christ and our walk with God produces this fruit. And where this can get confusing, I think, even as we light the candle of joy, is that sometimes we look at Christmas and we think, well, Christmas is a season of joy. But what's wrong, do you think, perhaps, of saying that Christmas is a season of joy? Is that wrong? Does it discolor things a little bit? To say that this is the season of joy. It's not all year round, right? So let's talk about some examples, right? What are some other things that we have seasons for?
Thanksgiving
season, okay. Holiday season, right? What else?
Valentine's,
okay. Yeah, kind of a season of love kind of thing going on.
Easter
season, okay. How about not holidays?
Everything else.
Why does John Wessler get really excited in November?
Hunting
season, right? Or baseball season, or football season. When you have seasons, it means a short amount of the calendar we set aside for this activity. And so I'm not knocking Advent, and we love Advent, but we have to be careful as we look at joy. That no, Christmas isn't just a season of joy, because then it gives the impression that this is the time of the year when you should be really joyful. And Megan, you brought it up just a few minutes ago, right? Sometimes this time of year is difficult to be joyful. Amen? If you have experienced loss, it's hard to be. I'll be honest, I was not feeling joyful yesterday about 3:30. When we've experienced hardship, or we have memories of hardship, even this time of year, it's hard to feel happy or to feel joyful. And so we might feel guilty about that, and we might think, but this is the time of year I'm supposed to be joyful. I'm supposed to be happy. And so we might feel I have to make myself feel joyful. But listen, you can't make yourself feel joyful any more than you can make grapes by squeezing a grapevine. It doesn't work that way. It's our connection to God that produces the joy. It has to be produced in us through the Holy Spirit. Joy comes from deep within ourselves. It outlasts our circumstances. It doesn't mean that we always feel happy if we have joy within us, but instead, we can be joyful even when we're not happy, because it comes from deeper within. We experience all of the range of emotions that we experience as human beings. It's natural for us to experience, but joy keeps those emotions in context. I'm sad today, but I know I can still have joy from within myself. I'm ecstatic today because of something that's happened, but I understand that that is not the source of my joy. Me doing well financially is not the source of my joy. Things going well at work is not the source of my joy. The fact that I'm in this relationship with somebody that I'm crazy about is not the source of my joy. That my relationship with God is the source of my joy. But we do pay a lot of attention to joy at Christmas, don't we? What is joyful about the Christmas season?
Christ's birth.
Jamie and I have just noticed, like, this year, it seems like more people have lights up. Like, during the COVID era, it just seemed like nobody was putting out lights, at least here in New Paris. And now, there's lights everywhere. It's really cool to see. The decorations are something that just, I don't know, brings out that Christmas feeling, right? But the truth is, there's a lot of joy in the Christmas story. And I want to encourage you to turn to Luke chapter 1. We're going to be looking at some passages on the slide. But in Luke chapter 1, I'm going to give the short 10,000-foot version of what happens in Luke 1. But it's a story of how God begins to go to work in bringing about the birth of Jesus Christ. And it doesn't start with Jesus, actually. It starts with this guy named Zechariah and his wife, Elizabeth, who God shows up to Zechariah when he's in the temple and says, guess what? Your wife is going to have a baby. He's like, yeah, right, my wife is old. And God says, no, she's going to have a baby, and he's going to be the one that prepares the way for the Lord. You're to name him John. So Elizabeth becomes pregnant. Then the angel Gabriel shows up to this virgin named Mary and says, Mary, you're highly exalted, and you're going to give birth to the Messiah. She's like, okay, I'm not married yet, and that's not really possible. And the angel says, no, the Holy Spirit is going to do this work within you. And so Mary conceives by the Holy Spirit. So Elizabeth and Mary, both expecting, Mary goes to visit her cousin Elizabeth. And that's where we pick up the story right here. At the time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. The baby in my womb leaped for joy. So as a surprise to you, I'm sure I've never given birth, right? Ladies who have had children, what is it like to feel a baby kick within you?
Joy.
Joy. Anything else? Because I got to tell you, it's a sensation I just can't even imagine. I mean, I've eaten some Taco Bell before that hasn't gone right, and I thought maybe that was happening. But to feel that child within you moving, and you realize that there's a living person inside of there moving around, that's got to be incredible. I remember when Jamie was pregnant with Eva and Aaron, just kind of feeling her belly, and you feel the little kick. It's just so fun. But, and we've experienced this in our family. Eva's not here this morning. She's actually at another church with her dance group dancing for a Christmas thing at another church. But Eva's always been a dancer. Even within the womb, she was a dancer. And we know that because when Jamie gave birth to Eva, we discovered that Eva had done so many somersaults and flips and all the, she actually tied her umbilical cord in a knot. It is a miracle of God that Eva is alive today because she was dancing in the womb. Why do you think, though, that not only was Elizabeth happy to hear her baby kick, why did Elizabeth perceive it as that the kick was a jump for joy? That John was jumping for joy. How did she perceive that?
Because of her joy.
Okay? When you're joyful, it's easy to perceive joy in other people, right? It says in the passage that she was filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit helped her see that what was happening, this was no ordinary kick. This kick was in response to the fact that the Savior of the world that John was going to proclaim was coming. The Savior of the world had just walked into the room, and the Holy Spirit says, whoa, that kick was not just a kick. Because God is bringing joy into the world. We also see joy in Mary's response. The next slide says this. Later on it says, and Mary said, my soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed. She says, I rejoice in God my Savior. Why? Because God has kept his promise to Abraham when he said, I will bless all people on earth through you. And Mary, despite her poverty from this rinky-dink little town called Nazareth, God chooses her to give birth to the Savior of the world, this teenage girl. We see joy also in the Christmas story after Christ's birth, at his dedication. The next slide says this, Luke 2. Simeon took him, the baby Jesus, in his arms and praised God, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. Now you could say, well, yeah, but the word joy doesn't appear anywhere in this passage, Pastor Jeff, and I'm using a different translation than the NIV. No, the word joy doesn't show up, but what word does? Praise. Because here's the thing. Praise flows downstream from joy. When we have joy in our lives, the natural result is that we give praise to God. When we are joyful, we can't help but praise. In fact, authentic praise is not possible without joy. We can stand up here as a worship team and we can sing the top of our lungs and we can put on a good show. And if there's no joy in our lives, it's not genuine praise. Authentic praise isn't possible without joy. So why does Simeon rejoice to hold baby Jesus? Why is that a joyful moment for him?
There's a
promise. The promise that God had made to Israel to send a Savior. The promise that God had made to Simeon to say, you're not going to die until you see the Savior. Now, we might assume that he was an old man. We don't know that for sure. He could have been 38 for all we know. But God had revealed to him, you're not leaving this existence until you have held in your arms Savior of the world, and he did. He rejoices because of God's promise. There's a lot of joy in the Christmas story. But brothers and sisters, I want us to remember this morning that Christ's birth isn't the real source of our joy. We rejoice in it. But if Jesus was just born into the world, that in and of itself wouldn't be something to be joyful for. We're going to get to what that source of joy is in a minute, but I want to ask another kind of open-ended question. What is your favorite hymn or worship song, and why? Who wants to share?
Amazing
Grace. Why is Amazing Grace your favorite song? He gives us grace. Over and over. Good. Anybody else? Why is that your favorite?
Vilest of sinners.
Amen. Vilest of sinners who believes, yes, receives from Jesus a pardon. That moment from Jesus, a pardon receives. Good. Anybody else? Yeah. Why is that your favorite?
Tells
the whole story. I heard somebody else.
When we all get to heaven.
That's the goal. That's the hope.
We all.
When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. We have favorite hymns, right? We have favorite modern songs, maybe on the radio, the one that just kind of sticks in your head, right? We go to the next slide. Isaac Watts was a man. Actually, at one point, he was a teenager. That's a surprise, right? He was born in 1674. As a teenager, Isaac Watts loved Jesus with all of his heart, but he hated church music. Anybody been there as a teenager? Like, I can't stand the songs we're singing. There have been times that when I was a teenager, I didn't particularly care for certain songs that we would sing in church. But For Isaac Watts, he didn't like the church music of his day, which tended to be like some of the Psalms, but put to really bad music, and sometimes very even poorly written. In fact, next slide, this is an example of a hymn that they would sing in church. Ye monsters of the bubbling deep, your master's praises spout. Up from the sands, ye docklings peep and wave your tails about. This is what he sang in church. And he said, that's no good. Now, I couldn't figure out what docklings were. So I go to the next slide. I go on to DuckDuckGo. I typed in, what are docklings? The entire internet didn't have an answer for me. It thought, well, maybe he means ducklings. I guess maybe up from the sands ye ducklings peep. But now I'm realizing that this hymn is essentially saying that all the ducklings need to shake their booties for God. Okay, I suppose. And Isaac Watts would look at this kind of hymn and say, that's just not, there's no joy really in that. It's not relatable. And he also had a problem with the way that people sang the hymns in church. We can go to the next slide. This is what he said. He said, to see the dull indifference, the negligent and thoughtless air that sits upon the faces of a whole assembly while the psalm is upon their lips, might even tempt a charitable observer to suspect the fervency of their inward religion. Let's put that in English. What's he saying? There's no joy when they sing. They just kind of say mouth the words, and there's no feeling behind it, and it makes you wonder, like, do they really believe in Jesus or not? And so, like the father of any teenager would, Isaac Watts' dad said to him, well, son, if you don't like the way that the hymns are written, why don't you just write your own? So we did. Isaac Watts wrote hundreds of hymns. I think there's 16 of them in our hymnal. Some of the more famous ones were, O God, our help in ages past, we're marching to Zion, and when I survey the wondrous cross. Ones that we are familiar with. But his most famous one is the most famous Christmas carol. What is that? Not Silent Night. Joy to the World. Joy to the World. Actually, we're not going to sing it this morning. You'll have to wait till next week. But turn in your hymnal to number 125. And look over the lyrics. Because here's the question with Joy to the World. Is there anything in Joy to the World about Christ's birth? The Lord has come, okay? Now, we know Christ comes twice, right? 2,000 years ago he came, and we know he's coming back again at some point in the future. Here's the thing. Joy to the World was not written as a Christmas carol. He did not have Christmas in mind. It's written about the second coming of Christ. But it's kind of become the most famous Christmas carol that's sung this time of year. But look at the lyrics. There, the second verse, joy to the world, the Savior reigns, right? As he's describing Christ has come back to the earth, and he now reigns over all creation. Verse 3, no more let sins and sorrows grow. In other words, sin no longer exists. It's been wiped out forever, and nobody's going to cry anymore. Nobody's going to mourn anymore. That's about Christ's return. He bases it on Psalm 98, actually, the psalm that I read at the beginning of the service. Now, it's not bad that we sing it at Christmas. It's joy to the world, yes, but let us remember, though, that the connection there is that the joy that we have does not stem simply from Christ being born, but the fact that Jesus Christ has overcome death for us. That Jesus Christ is the one who is coming again. We celebrate his birth because it's the birth of the one who went to the cross for us, who overcame sin for us, who was raised from the dead for us, and now is at the right hand of the Father, pleading, praying for us in accordance with the Father's will, and that he's coming back. And then the words to this hymn are going to be fully realized. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Not for the first time, but forever. This is the reason we have joy. So, real quick before we end, two scriptures that illustrate the source of our joy. Psalm 16, we go to this slide. This is, Jesus says this on the night that he was betrayed. says Jesus saw that they wanted to ask him about this, so he said to them, "Are you asking one another what I meant when I said, 'In a little while you will see me no more, and then after a little while you will see me'? Very truly I tell you, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come, but when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that a child is born into the world. So with you, now is your time of grief, but I will see you again, and you will rejoice, and no one will take away your joy." So here's the question. Why are the disciples about to grieve?
His death.
He's about to die. They don't understand it. They don't believe it. They don't think Jesus is ever going to die. He's going to throw out Rome and everything's going to be hunky-dory from now on. They don't understand. No, Jesus is about to die. So Jesus says, look, you're going to grieve, but the world is going to rejoice. Now, why does the world rejoice? Because the Romans didn't like Jesus. The Jewish leaders didn't like Jesus. Many people didn't like Jesus, and so they rejoiced when he died. But then Jesus says, but your grief will turn into joy. When will their grief turn into joy? On Sunday morning, when he's raised from the dead. Now your grief will turn into joy. And Jesus says, and nobody will take away your joy. The source of our joy is not simply Christ being born. It's the fact that Jesus Christ has been raised from the dead. And what that means for us, that he has overcome death, and we will share in the same resurrection that he had when he returns one day. He is proven to be the King of Kings. And so that blessed assurance, it allows us to rejoice even during hardship, even during loss, when our emotions are all over the place, running from happy to sad to depressed to ecstatic. No matter what our emotions are, we can still have that joy because we understand that Jesus Christ has overcome death and what that means to us. And as Bill and Gloria Gaither wrote, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. That's the difference between happiness and joy. Happiness says, I can't do this because I'm not happy. Joy says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. One more slide. Hebrews 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. And I made bigger and italicized that phrase, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. What was the joy that was set before Jesus? Was it the cross?
Resurrection.
Ah, it was a resurrection. He wasn't really looking forward to the cross, was he? I mean, three times he prayed, Lord, if it is possible for this cup to be taken from me, please. It wasn't the cross. It was what lay beyond the cross. The resurrection and the fact that when he took that cup upon himself, when he died for us, it opened up the way for our salvation. The joy that was set before him was the knowledge that he was going to reign in heaven with all of us when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be because he has gone to the cross for us. He looks forward to the joy that exists beyond the cross. The victory over sin that restored us to God and the promise of his kingdom. The final victory over Satan and the world being remade and us reigning with him forever. The source of Christ's joy is the same source of our joy. So we rejoice not simply in Christ's birth, but in the promise of his second coming. So, talk about application. If you're finding joy difficult this year, you can hang your stocking on this. Christ restored you to God through the cross. He set you free from sin by his resurrection. And he promises you his eternal salvation when he returns in glory. Joy to the world will be realized one day. Know that joy in this season, it doesn't come from presents, it doesn't come from food, it doesn't even come from family. It doesn't come from parties or Christmas trees or Christmas music. Jesus Christ is the source of our joy and our relationship with him. Also understand this, that living with joy is not a result of your efforts. Not a pull yourselves up by the bootstraps and be joyful. It's living by the Holy Spirit. Living in a walk with Christ and the Holy Spirit guiding you through your day. You can't manufacture joy. It's generated as you walk with Jesus. And it's not just a Christmas thing. We put away the decorations in January. We don't put away our joy. It's something we carry with us all year long. We're going to enter into a time of communion. Because, as I said, what brings us the joy is the knowledge that our sins have been forgiven through the cross. I want to preface this by saying, look, the bread and the cup are here. If you are in a point where you feel like you can receive it because you have made things right with Christ, you are welcome to join us in this communion. We examine ourselves before we take the bread and the cup because remember that this represents the blood of Jesus and the body of Jesus. But all who have put their faith in Christ are welcome to come. Paul says this in 1 Corinthians 11. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.' Whenever you eat this cup and drink, whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." I'm going to invite Doug and Peggy to come forward, and they're going to hold the elements for us. Will you pray with me as we prepare for communion? Father in heaven, today we rejoice. Not because of our circumstances. We rejoice because we walk in fellowship with God himself because of what Jesus Christ did for us at the cross. Lord, in this moment, I want to thank you for the body of Christ, which was broken for us. And the reason we take the bread into ourselves is a reminder that it is only through Christ's death that we have hope of resurrection. It is only through Christ's death that we have the joy that we have. Thank you for dying for us, Jesus. And Lord, we thank you for the blood of Jesus that was shed for us, that wipes clean the slate. Lord, we are all hopeless sinners. There's not a one of us in here. It doesn't matter who our parents were. It doesn't matter how righteous we considered ourselves, how good we were, how terrible we were. Whether we consider ourselves a good person or we consider ourselves the lowest of the low, there's not a one of us that has a hope of heaven. Except for the blood of Jesus. In Christ alone, we have forgiveness of sins. Lord, I confess to you, I'm a sinner. I need your salvation. I need it as much today as I've ever needed it. Please forgive me for my sins. Sins I'm aware of and sins that I'm not aware of. Things that I'm not even aware of them. I've just do because I'm a sinner. Forgive me, Father. And I ask, Lord, that your grace would reign in my life, that you would help me to live by your Spirit and help me to be joyful because of the life that you've given me. pray these things in Jesus' name. I invite you to come forward and receive the elements. You can just kind of come around this side, come to the front, and then make your way back to your seat. Actually, well, you guys switch.
Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. I'm going to sing a couple of songs. I would invite you to, as the Lord leads you, if you need a couple minutes just to sit there and reflect, you're welcome to do that. We're going to sing a couple songs. We're going to start with Christmas Eve in Bethlehem, which is a reminder of making room in our hearts for the Lord.
When I turned down.
which is a Christmas carol, looking forward to Christ's birth, but we sing it, understanding he's coming back. So let's sing, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. You may stand as you, if you would like.
Thank you.
God came to earth. He died for us. He was raised again. And Lord, we look forward to the day when Emmanuel, God with us, will come again to set all things right, to end death, to end misery, to end sickness, to end injustice, that we may look upon the face of our Creator and Savior and hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Fill us, Father, with your Spirit. May we rejoice and praise this week as we leave here. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for coming today. Hope you can join us for Christmas caroling. Tonight, next week, we have worship at 10:15 and then the Christmas Eve service at 8. God bless you.